This is the BBC.
Hello, I'm Kirsty Young. Thank you for downloading this podcast of Desert Island Discs from BBC Radio 4. This is an extended edition of the original broadcast. For rights reasons, the music choices are shorter than in the radio broadcast. For more information about the programme, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4. My castaway this week is the TV presenter Sue Perkins. With her ready wit and genuine warmth, she is one of our most recognisable small screen stars. Plying her trade for 20 years now, it was, of course, the irresistible recipe of steaming great poods and saucy quips that ensured her household name status. Along with her long-term comedy partner Mel Giedroyc, she made the Great British Bake Off so much more than just another disposable telly format, turning it into a ratings sensation and a national obsession. These days, she wears her considerable celebrity with wry aplomb in her travel odyssey documentaries and best-selling memoir, hints at someone keen as much for understanding as approval. She says, "I am an appalling, appalling softie. But somehow, somewhere along the line, I've learned how to hide it, hide that sentimentality and vulnerability. I do it with words, bluster. It fortifies me against the outside world. Take away the words and I am lost." So welcome, Sue Perkins. Plenty of words today. When you think about a sojourn onto this island all alone, how does it leave you feeling?
Pure terror.
Does it?
It does, because I'm never alone. I've rather happily constructed a life where I'm always with an other, a partner, with friends and family, where my work is incredibly sociable. And my entire reason for being is to connect with people and to understand what makes them tick. And to just be around palm trees and water, much as I love nature, will be so disorientating. And I have a sort of almost a sort of shimmer of anxiety thinking about it.
It's gone into showbiz legend now that you and Mel famously turned down the Great British Bake Off.
Yes.
How are you with decision making generally?
Terrible. Absolutely terrible. I'm such a prevaricator. I only see grey. I'm very glad. I'm always very glad I'm not responsible wholly for my own career choices.
We know you are not, as you famously said with Mel in that statement that ran almost top of the news, you are not following the dough. Paul is going off to this new series on Channel 4, Paul Hollywood, of course. Mary is staying with the BBC. I mean, how much of a wrench was it? And I wonder, after so many series of doing it, was there a bit of you that thought, I'm sad, but really I feel like I could do with a bit of freedom now?
It's a complicated brew, actually, that. There was lots of things going on. I think it was an extraordinary chunk of my life, and it shepherded me through. It was one sort of continuum in a 7 years that were full of quite a lot of upheaval in my own life. Mm-hmm. I think we were running out of puns. I'm not going to lie, Kirsty. There's only so many in the tank. I think when we had a Croatian bun and I said rather loudly it had split, and I thought I have really, really sunk to the very bottom of what is possible in my. And, every bap pun, every Hungarian ring pun was just mined and mined and mined. And we did a Tudor week and some of the puns there were absolutely horrific. One of them was, "That's an Aragon." It was absolutely terrible. It was really awful, really awful. But I would have carried on doing it, I think. It was a really sweet show. I loved the crew and I loved the director and I loved the bakers and I sort of loved all of it. But there was one point, I'll be honest, where I did think, can I do this forever? Which was when I had come back from my travels and it was a programme I did in the Mekong River and I had been travelling from the mouth in Ho Chi Minh to the source in Tibet. And 4 days before I came to the Bake Off tent, I had been with the first family of the Mekong in Tibet, who had no electricity and no running water. And they would have yak butter and barley, and that's all they ate. And they would meditate and be in bed by six. And then 4 days later, I was in a tent where somebody was crying because they couldn't find the packet of marron glacé. And I did think, how can I rationalise these two worlds? But I miss it, and I also wish it well. There's no point in rancour.
Let's turn to the music, Sue Perkins. Tell me about the first one we're going to hear this morning, then.
Well, for someone who just gasses off continuously, the only time when I'm not talking is when I'm dancing, and I love dancing. And I'm not a great dancer. I think you might have witnessed some of my dancing. I mean, it's expressive, is it not?
I think that would be one word.
I don't do things by halves. So I'm like this sort of electrocuted octopus when I get on the dance floor. And I'm not a young buck anymore, but it doesn't matter. I will just go for it with the same vim and pep as I had when I was in my 20s. And this track is Sylvester, You Make Me Feel. Open brackets, mighty real, close brackets. And I think of all the dance tracks that I love, this is the one that is most likely to get everyone at home, you know, moving their hips like a gyroscope. So just go for it.
That was Sylvester and You Make Me Feel Mighty Real. Your memoir, Spectacles, when it came out in 2015, I read it at the time, and it was funny enough not to be safe to read on public transport. You know that thing,
you think,
might laugh explosively at any point. You're able to write in a very funny way. What makes you laugh?
I have sort of a broad taste, I suppose. Sometimes a really nuanced, really finessed, satirical kind of sentence can make me guffaw, but equally, just a really well-timed burp. Do you know what I mean? It's just a beautiful, beautiful... I once accidentally did a burp whilst opening the fridge that sounded like a fridge door opening, and I laughed for 15 minutes. I thought I was going to die. And I think the great thing about humour is it connects you to your childish self. I'm not snobbish about jokes, and I'm not snobbish about where they come from. And if something makes me laugh, I'll accept it for what it is and be truly grateful.
What are you looking for in your work? I mean, you mentioned the Mekong Delta tour. You've been to, so there's Vietnam, there's China, India, Alaska, making these documentaries that take, I imagine, what, you must be shooting those for 2 or 3 months
yes.
at a time. It's a huge commitment.
Yeah.
You're away from friends and family. I imagine often in quite difficult conditions shooting them. What's the appeal for you? Why do you put yourself through that?
I ask myself that a lot, and people who care about me ask that a lot. And there's a sort of perverse need always in me to push myself. I come back always with, you know, a sort of payload of E. coli or some such. But what I get from it is a sense of connecting with people who I am sort of practically as far removed from as possible. My life is as far removed from theirs as it's humanly possible to be. I can flick a switch and I have light. I can turn on the shower and I have warm water. There was one time when we were travelling and we were in Ratnakiri in northern Cambodia, and all the translators just left. It's the Kurung tribe I went to see, and in order to understand, to get the translation across, we'd need to go from English to Khmer, from Khmer to another tribal dialect, and from that dialect to Kurung. But there were no translators. So you're stuck in this clearing with 30 women looking at you. And you have to find a way of saying, we're all the same. And it was a fart gag that did it in the end. But also I managed to sit down. They asked me to sit down, and I managed to sit down on an enormous pile of pig poo. And that was a real icebreaker. And they thought I was a spectacular idiot. But through just looking at them and holding their hands and laughing, I managed to spend nearly 3 days with them. And I was walking through a cashew forest with one of them holding my hand. And I just loved this woman so much. I thought, how can I feel so strongly about a stranger with whom I don't share a language? And I just said to her, I really feel I've known you all my life. And she muttered something back. She was making a very long pipe, I remember. And about 2 months later, when the translation came back and the show was ready to be sort of edited and voiced, they rung me up and said, you need to watch this. And there's me saying, well, I think I've known you all my life. And the translation came back and she said, I think I've known you all my life. And that's why I do it, because in all the hardship and madness and all the filth, there's just this reminder that we're all the same. And there's this reminder that you can have these immense, profound moments of solidarity. And I that's what I always look for.
We're going to hear some more music, Sue Perkins. Tell me about this. Why have you chosen this?
So this is the first track I ever remember hearing. And this is Lonnie Donegan's Rock Island Line. And my dad was a great dancer. And it reminds me of him. This track builds, and it's that sense of excitement that I get if I go clubbing when you're waiting for the deep bass to kick in. It's about waiting. It's about pleasure delay. It's about seeing, for me, my dad just gently sort of bouncing up and down and corralling all of us kids to get ready for the big moment when the song explodes. And I just love it. And it reminds me of family. And I can see our front room with that awful swirly 70s carpet and the stink of sort of Fray Bentos pie simmering in the 1970s oven, an overcooked cabbage sort of limp and beige, and just pure joy at having the privilege of these people being my blood relatives.
I'll tell you where I'm going, boy. Down the Rock Island Line, she's a mighty good road. The Rock Island Line is a road to ride. Yes, the Rock Island Line, she's a mighty good road. And if you want to ride, you got to ride it like you find to get your ticket at the station on the Rock Island Line. I may be right, I may be wrong. You know you're gonna miss me when I'm gone. Down the Rock Island Line, she's a mighty good road.
That was Lonnie Donegan and Rock Island Line. You surely did enjoy that, Sue Perkins.
I certainly did.
You were born at the end of the 60s. You were brought up in Croydon. You've described it as less of a place, more of a punchline. Your dad, Bert, was a car dealer and your mum, Anne, was a secretary. Just tell me more about them.
So they had this extraordinary, peculiar and eccentric marriage that was a beautiful thing to behold. My mum is fiercely bright and very creative, and my dad was sensitive and funny. And what they shared, and I think what welded them together, apart from love, pure love, was a total lack of self-esteem. And that I look on it and I think I sort of see that as the cement. And they sort of shepherded each other through decades and decades and decades, the three unruly kids and the highs and lows of life. And Dad sort of felt too much. He sort of relied on data. He would keep lists and...
Lists of what?
Anything. He would keep notes on the fluctuations in temperature, on when the sun rose and when the sun set. He collected stamps and would make huge long lists about watermarks and perforations. He would catalogue everything, because that was a way of providing order in a universe that is essentially chaotic.
And your mother was a catastrophizer.
A total catastrophizer. So during the anthrax scare, she opened all of her mail with marigold gloves.
Did she really do that? Because I read that in your book and of course I laughed, but I wasn't sure if you were telling
the truth. It's all true. I mean, it's all, you know, and would ring me up. I remember when I was at college, I just had an answering machine message which said, just so you know, the latest thing that's going on in London is that someone will flash their headlights at you. And, you know, when you stop the car, they'll pull you out the car and carjack you. And I don't know where she'd read that, but I think in her head it happened all the time. And everyone who was driving was going to be sort of subjected to this.
And what about the way you see yourself? You've said that as a kid you were freakishly pale and perpetually odd and terribly shy.
Those things exist to this present day. It's just I'm better at masking them. I mean, that's all you can hope for in terms of maturity. Those feelings don't go away, but you learn coping mechanisms.
What do you feel your oddness to be?
The same as everyone else's oddness. That sense of being outside, looking in. And I used to think that was a peculiar thing to being a teenager. But of course, it sort of endures. I'm sure everybody would say that. Sometimes I felt like an outsider because I was a woman. Sometimes because I don't have kids. Sometimes because I'm gay. Sometimes because I'm not 20 anymore. There's always a reason to be outside the glass.
And so you went to a Catholic school at one point. How did you get on with the nuns? How were the nuns?
Well, I mean, you'd be hard-pressed, I think, to listen to any story of a young girl and nuns that turned out well. I mean, the nuns were terrifying. They would sort of appear like sort of strange elderly bats and corral you and make you do things you didn't want to do. And in my case, I'm left-handed, and it's strange to think. I mean, this is the mid-70s, but you were hit if you ate your food left-handed, then they would swoop down. And
was that a sort of daily... That sounds like a daily trauma for a little girl to go into that environment.
I don't see it as such. I think it gave me the feeling of being watched and being scrutinised, which isn't particularly healthy.
Yes.
And I suppose, you know, mine's greater than mine could then extrapolate as to, you know, why I do what I do for a living now. But I did get my own back, though. I was eating... I was being forced to eat some mashed potato, which was delivered rather lovelessly from one of those ice cream scoops. It was this perfect semicircle of sort of rock-hard starch. It was being plonked on your plate. And I flicked it. And Sister Mary Dorothy was walking past and slipped on it and skidded and shattered her leg against the wall. And I, for a brief second, I thought, I really am.
There is a
the
God.
Antichrist.
Yeah. Let's have some more music, Sue Perkins.
Well, we were talking about being on the outside looking in, and I don't think anybody describes what that feeling is like better than Morrissey. I love the Smiths. But I've picked How Soon Is Now simply because of the lyric, I'm the son and heir of a shyness that is criminally vulgar. I'm the son and heir of nothing in particular. And a big shout to Johnny Marr, who just provides these searing guitar moments that just elevate that song into something truly, truly special. And I don't think anyone can listen to a Smith song and not scream your lungs out in recognition of what it's like to feel odd.
I'm the son and the heir of a shyness that is criminally vulgar. I am the son and heir of nothing in particular. Shut your mouth, how can you say? I go about things the wrong way. I am human and I need to be loved, just like everybody else.
How Soon Is Now, that was the Smiths. Sue Perkins, what made you decide to study English at Cambridge?
Genuinely, it's because one of my teachers told me that I should study something other than English at a polytechnic, or maybe not bother. And all my life I'm a contrary soul. If I'm told I can't, I will.
And why were they telling you that? Was it the poverty of expectation at your school, or was it the belief that you were not up to the job?
I think it was a combination of the two. I certainly at school was not a consistent pupil.
So your report cards would have been sort of all A's and all E's, would they?
Exactly that.
Right.
Exactly that. And I certainly was unruly, and particularly in science and maths, which I didn't fully embrace. And I think because there was that huge bandwidth between me doing well, you know, the A's and the E's, I think they'd never thought I'd amount to very much. I mean, one of my report cards, I remember saying, what Susan lacks in intelligence, she makes up for in stupidity. I'm not joking. That stayed with me, you know.
I hope you framed that and put it in the loo.
Well, for a long time, I had that thing that I said about, you know, I need to go to a college and not do English. That was on my wall for a while. And I just sort of, as soon as I'd been told I couldn't, I took myself slightly out of school and I started to read a lot on my own. And I remember going to my dad and I said, Dad, what's the best university? And neither of my parents went to university, but my dad said, I think Cambridge is the best. And so I said, all right, I'll go there then. And because I was so unaware of what that would involve, and I was unaware of the magnitude of it, and there wasn't any pressure on my shoulders to do anything or be anyone. I did it.
But you had to. Did you have to work very hard to get in? Did you have to really sort of apply yourself with determination to get the results?
Well, the thing is, I remember my dad driving me, put on his best camel coat, and got in the car, which was a knackered old Peugeot, and we sort of puttered up to Cambridge, and I'd got an interview. And we just thought we'd be there for half an hour. And then it transpired that actually it was a whole day of interviews and an exam. And those interviews, as terrifying as they were the sort of making of me, because they got to see who I was. And because I had been spending a lot of time, you know, really considering what I felt about Wuthering Heights, or what I felt about Tess of the D'Urbervilles, or what I felt about Hamlet, I was able to talk about it. So they actually gave me an offer that was achievable.
It was 1988 when you went there, and I understand that at the time your dad said to you, don't become posh.
Yes. Ship has sailed, Dad, sorry.
How did you fit in when you first got there?
I was sort of overwhelmed by the beauty of the place, and I had no context for that kind of majesty, really, and I felt very cowed by it at the beginning. But very quickly, I just started meeting people that I fell in love with. So the first moment I walked into my room, they'd said, do you want to share a room? And I thought, well, I might as well, because I'll know somebody then. And then this mad, flame-haired Welsh woman arrived called Shayla, and I shared a room with her in the first year, and I just loved the bones of her. And she thought that everybody from the south of England owned their own pony. And she used to speak in Welsh quite a lot. And we were so different, but we just loved each other. And from that moment on, I just relaxed and I really loved college. And I met the people there that I will know and love for the rest of my life.
And how did a young woman who had described herself as a kid as shy end up at Footlights on stage?
Because of Shayla and because of this strange compulsion in me to do what is least expected, to challenge myself, to take on dares.
Did she tell you you were funny, that you needed to share the funny?
No, I mean, I think she found me faintly idiotic, not necessarily funny. And there was a comedy night going on, and I said, oh, I want to go. And she went, just do it. And I said, what do you mean? She goes, just do a slot. I'll give you a tenner. Tenner was a fortune then. And because she challenged me and because it felt like the most exciting and frightening thing to do, I did it. And I stood there that night in a very itchy lamb's wool jumper under a single very bright spotlight and just improvised some stuff. And that was the first time I'd ever stood in front of an audience.
What was the sensation?
Fear, a prickling of fear, giving way to an extraordinary sense of freedom. You have that moment of, oh, my God, I am going to do this. And then you set yourself free and you're just buffeted by the currents, in this case, the audience. And you don't know where it's going, but you just have this blind faith that everything's going to be OK. And whereas some people might ascribe that to a feeling of pure terror, to not know where you're going, to not know the destination, weirdly for me, I just find that that's my safe space. God, I sound mad now. I sound properly insane. But when it goes well, when you're just improvising and playing with an audience, it's so liberating. I love it.
Let's hear your fourth, Sue. What are we going to hear now?
Well, now this has a very, very special place in my heart. This is T-Rex, 20th Century Boy. And this track reminds me of an old Polish woman I know called Melanie Giedroyc. And sometimes we will just leave messages on one another's phone, which will just be, which will be, you know, the singers in this track. So this is for her.
Do it for us again. That was T-Rex and 20th Century Boy. As Sue Perkins, there is this beguiling ease between you and Mel Giedroyc when we watch you on screen. It's a kind of sisterly partnership, like all good double acts. You seem to not just be able to finish each other's sentences, but make the best of each other and make each other, I'm guessing, funnier than you might be if you were just on your own. I mean, you've been together, what, 30 years as a partnership?
Yes, next year it'll be 30 years since we met in that at that gig, at that very gig.
And what was your first impression of Mel?
For the first thing I noticed was she had some dusky pink DMs, 8-hole DMs. I just thought, I want those more than I've wanted anything in this world. And then I looked up and I saw the shock of bleach blonde hair and this profusion of teeth, like a sort of broken piano, and this hearty laugh. And I just felt compelled, I'd never met her before, to just move into her orbit. And I just knew we'd know each other forever from that moment, really. And people talk a lot about falling in love and romantic relationships, but they didn't talk about, you know, platonic friendships and how powerful they can be. You know, we have seen each other through such highs and lows, and above and beyond our working relationship, we are friends and we love each other and we want the best for each other.
When you were first gigging together, 1993 was the first Edinburgh Festival you did, and this was at the time of emerging talents like Joe Brand and Steve Coogan and Lee Evans. How did it go for you, that first festival? That's a big moment to put yourself up on stage.
Well, in classic Mel Sue fashion, we were a total shambles. It's a wonder that we've managed to make anything of ourselves because we're so haphazard. You know, our partnership looks inward. We look at each other and we never look outwards. It's like two twins in a cot, just marvelling. Just marvelling at each other. And I think sometimes that's our greatest strength and our greatest failing, because I think if we'd been more able to sort of see the wood for the trees, then I think our careers would have gone a bit smoother. But we decided we wanted to do Edinburgh quite late in the day. And the only time they had left this venue was 10:05 in the morning.
Oh.
So not even 10 o'clock, which is a time that people can remember to be at the 10:05. And we hadn't finished writing the show. We put it on. Nobody was in the audience. And we performed to 2 people, 3 people for the entirety of that festival until I think maybe day 20. And an article came out talking about new acts on the fringe, and we were mentioned. And then our little room was full.
By 1997, you'd made it onto television. You were the name Light Lunch as a TV show evokes a certain sort of misty-eyed fondness in certain people. I have to admit to being one of those people. And it was 1997 on Channel 4, and that was really your big break. I have been told that there was a considerable degree of chaos between you as a partnership, including, you can put me right here if this is wrong, somebody saying, yeah, I mean, they don't have a clue. The truth is, we're having to buy them underwear. Is that true?
Yes. I don't know if that bought his underwear, but and I think the production company had never come across anyone like the pair of us, because we were so blissfully unaware of the jazz hands element of television, you know, that we had to have sort of makeup and, you know, our hair had to be properly styled and, you know, we had to have a proper fitting bra, and it probably wasn't a good idea, you just wore your old grey pants. But I'm happy in old grey pants, and that's just the way we were. Oh, this is why I love Mel, is that the people on the show, they gave us this incredible break. But they were very well put together, very kind of West London kind of media people. And they
Slick.
And at the end of the first series, because it seemed to be going well, they bought us each a Prada purse. And I looked at this Prada purse and I just thought, who's that for? And Mel looked at it separately and said, who's that for? And without saying anything, we both gave it to the charity shop the next day. And it was only a month later that we confessed to each other. And that's happened a billion times in my relationship with Mel, including, of course, when everything happened with Bake Off. I didn't need to ring her and say, what are you going to do? Because I knew what she was going to do. It was merely a question of how we were going to do it.
Time for some more music, Sue Perkins. Tell me about what we're going to hear now. This is the fifth of your choices this morning.
Kate Bush is an artist that I have loved since I was a child. And her music has always been with me. When I talked about, you know, applying and getting into Cambridge, it was Hounds of Love that I would listen to. And I would turn the record over and over and over and over. And I love her because she's wistful and sentimental. I love her because she loves family. I love her because so much of her stuff is rooted in nature and the environment and what it is to feel in awe of birdsong and the rustle of trees. This is Moments of Pleasure because it's such so exquisite, but also it's just about looking back on one's life. Just cherry-picking those single moments that give you pause and make your heart sore.
Some moments that I've had, some moments of pleasure.
That was Kate Bush and Moments of Pleasure. You're a very quotable person, Sue Perkins, and yet another funny and interesting thing you've said is that being gay is about the 47th most interesting thing in my life. You are part of that generation that has witnessed an incredible sea change in society's attitude towards our sexuality. Mm. Growing up, did you know anyone who was gay?
Do you know, I don't think I did. I don't think I did. And then when I was 16, I met this boy and I completely fell in love with him. And we were together sort of 6.5 years and we really loved each other. And then I suppose I was at college and he was away, he was working. And he said, I'm not very well and I'm just going through some stuff. And the stuff that he was going through was the same stuff that I was going through, and we were both gay. And some people might not recognise that as, think, oh, you're just both gay, it's not real. It was so real. You know, it was a sexual relationship. It wasn't that we were bearding one another. But slowly we evolved. I came to my evolution quite late, you know, and I remember I was doing a sort of theatre and education show, and I remember saying to my friend, God, I'm just not eating. I don't know what's happening. I can't sleep and I can't eat. And then my friend said, "You're in love." And I just thought, I just want to throw up. And I was. And it came to nothing. It was an unrequited passion.
And you wanted to throw up because you thought, I'm in love with a woman.
Yeah, I just thought that's what it is. You say, did I know anybody that was gay? Yeah. It was so far from my frame of reference that when it was presented to me as a truth, I had that violent reaction. And then it all made sense. And because I came to it quite late, I was in my 20s, it's like having a second adolescence. You know, you think you've gone through being a teenager. And I was, you know, I was a stroppy teenager and I acted out, but I didn't really rebel. And yet when I was in my 20s and I had this second sort of outsider moment, I really rebelled. And that's when I shaved my hair and I dyed my hair blue and I went nuts and I started drinking and going out all night. And, you know, that was it.
You say you drank quite heavily. In your memoirs, you talk about drinking heavily.
Yes, because I was shy. And I would go from being the shyest person in the room to being the person standing on a table dancing. Mm. And I became very, very sick. I got stomach ulcer. And I'm grateful to that stomach ulcer because I think it was too easy. It was too easy to be that drunk, actually. And I'm not sure that I would have escaped its clutches.
And what about the fluid nature of sexuality? I mean, do you think if you'd been in a different generation, the generation now that is coming to sexual maturity, you would have felt the need to come out as lesbian? Or do you think you just would have been a lot more...
Sort of been, you know, yes. it absolutely. I mean, I laugh and yet I'm hugely cheered by the fact that my goddaughter is at school and she's 14 and some of her friends identify as pansexual.
What even is that?
I don't know, but it doesn't matter. But it's just like, good for you. I've always thought it's a spectrum and I've been slightly dumbfounded and made furious by the fact that I was forced to make a binary choice because it's always about the person. But for me, I don't have any regrets, you know. What I try to do in interviews and stuff, and I am noticing it's happening less anyway, is to just downplay it as a thing. Mm. Because the more I can downplay it, the more that everyone else can. It's not... Why should people have to go through this painful, stressful, archaic ritual of going home to their parents and telling them that they're having sex? Because that's all they're doing. You know,
Did you officially come out to your parents?
Listen. My magnificent friend Sarah, who has no truck with this sort of stuff, said, look, if you don't tell them, then I'm going to go and tell them. So the gauntlet was laid down. So I rung up my... I think 28. I rung up my mum and I said, Mum, can I come home for tea tomorrow? She was eating toast. I remember she was like... crunching on the toast. She said, why do you want to come home? I said, well, I just want to come home and just talk to you and Dad and have tea and sit down and chat about stuff. And I carried on munching. And she went, is this because you're gay? I just was furious. I was like, yeah, it might be. She went, oh, well, that can wait. And that was my coming out. Everyone should have that experience of just their mum eating toast going, oh, God, it can wait. It can wait.
Tell me about your next piece of music then, Sue Perkins. What are we going to hear? It's your sixth.
Sometimes I think I talk and I'm sociable to avoid silence and solitude, because those are the times where I'll really feel the stuff that's happened to me. And this is Pergolesi's Starback Martyr. This is a piece, the architecture, which is very much based on sort of pain and resolution. Pain and resolution. Pain and resolution. A crunching together and then a release. That's what life is, of course, but I listen to it. And I give myself permission to cry, and I give myself permission to go to those dark spaces that words can't possibly hope to describe.
Was part of Pergolesi's Starback Martyr. Singing there were Emma Kirkby and James Bowman, with the Academy of Ancient Music conducted by Christopher Hogwood. Sue Perkins, it's not every castaway that I would ask what the most revolting thing they've ever put in their mouth is, but I'm going to ask you.
I've put terrible things in my mouth.
Go on.
Well, you know, I did a show with the food critic Giles Corran. It was called Supersizers. And in the course of that programme, which I loved doing, I had the restoration dish of bread and butter pudding with spinal cord.
Ooh.
I've eaten peacock, which was like shoe leather. I've eaten duck tongues, fallopian tubes. That was interesting. I mean, really,
is there anything you've refused?
Do you know? No, I have, but I have no capacity for refusal. You know, I've travelled a lot, and you go into a village and somebody offers you something, it's possibly a rat, but they've offered it. That's all they've got. It is beyond rude and ignorant to say no.
The purpose of these documentaries was social history through food. One of the series was about the Victorians, and there was a set of blood tests that you did. Do you do them every week?
The sort of bookend of the show was that we would get a blood test going in, and then we would eat that diet for a week, and then your blood would be measured at the end to see what effect the copious eating of meat and drinking of alcohol had on your system.
And then a moment came when you had the test done and one of the medics, the doctor involved, said, I need to talk to you about something else. Can you tell me about that?
So the Victorian show that we did, they wanted to focus on women, and they did a hormone profile. And as you say, I was asked to stay behind. I just didn't think anything of it. And in this small, very clinical, white little side room, this woman said, your bloods are very awry and you have a brain tumour. And there's always a delay for me. It's only really now that I consider the epic destruction this tiny little rice-shaped thing in my pituitary gland has caused. And so I said, oh, thank you very much. And I went away. And I don't even think I did anything about it for months, because I didn't want to know. She had, I think, said it was benign. But, of course, benign is very different from non-symptomatic. So I had a benign and extremely symptomatic brain tumour, which then started to kind of make its presence felt. I then went and had an MRI eventually, and then I went and had a consultation with a very eminent endocrinologist He asked me if I had kids, and I said, no, I don't. And he said, well, you can't have them. And then I went out. And I think then I did cry, and I rung my ex. I sat on a pavement. And it was the beginning of a very, very dark time. And, of course, when you've got something in your head, you don't know whether what you're feeling is real or not. And I got diagnosed when I was 38. By the time I was 40, I literally destroyed my life from the inside out. And it was only 6 months ago when I went for a second opinion and started medication. And the second endocrinologist looked at my bloods and said, but you must have behaved in ways that would confound people who loved you. And you must have been in such unimaginable confusion and anxiety and delirium. Did you do something that you regret? And I just lost it. I just lost it. I always like to think I'm accountable for everything that I do, good and bad. But I'll never understand how I did some of the things that I did. You know, I walked out of my life, I ended a relationship. One day I'd be catatonic with depression, the next I'd be at heart attack levels of anxiety. I would one day be showing a hormone profile that was just zero. Zero estrogen, zero progesterone, zero testosterone, with huge levels of prolactin. And the next day I'd be completely normal. And because I put up and shut up, because this is another challenge that must be met, I did nothing about it. And it's, as I say, it's taken this time to kind of look at the wreckage and to piece it together and to say sorry and to make amends and to be healthy and to be better. And that's a lifelong battle, I think. The problem with this condition is there's no continuum. But, God, I'm lucky because it might be symptomatic, but it's benign.
What I'm thinking about is that, the demands that are put on you professionally, where you are as well known as you are in it, where you are scrutinised, indeed when you are reported for things that you might say or things you might do or how you act and react. Handling the condition you have, that's a very, very difficult professional position that you are in. And have you thought about stepping away?
I think now I'm starting to get to that position. But I think I didn't have enough self-love for such a long time to take it seriously. And it was only through seeing somebody I really loved having a non-benign brain tumour that I thought,
this is
my
father,
dad.
Yeah. Yes.
And we talk about the clash, the collision between the personal and the public. The most profound example of that, and one that caused me such unimaginable pain, was when the book came out. I had written about the brain tumour that I have. And the day that the papers got hold of that story, they published it on the front page, I think it was 5 national newspapers, was the day after that I discovered that my dad had a terminal brain tumour.
Oh, God.
And so it was bake-off star in brain tumour shock or whatever. And I stood in a newsagent and I just thought, I'm going to lose my legs because no one knows what's going on. And I just wanted to scream, saying, but I'm OK and my dad isn't OK. And it was immensely painful. This extraordinary, brilliant man who taught me how to ride a bike and made up stories when I had the mumps, and who had such an extraordinary, precise, brilliant, funny way about him, started to lose his mind. Although rather brilliantly, I said to him, I think maybe it was a month before he died, I said, you know, Dad, you've always promised you'd play chess with me. My dad was a brilliant chess player and I'm useless. And he beat me in 20 moves. And they said, oh, come on, old girl, try. And then he beat me in 9. And I just loved him for that. But, so it's been a very challenging time. And I think the best thing that I can do to honour him is to get myself sorted and to take that time, knowing it's not a life-threatening condition, to at least make myself right.
Let's have some music soon. Tell me what this is.
This is an extraordinary track for me. This is Northern Sky by Nick Drake. It's one that makes me cry a lot. But also, when I was going through this really difficult time, when I was 40 and I'd ended this big relationship and was slowly going mad, I would listen to it. And then years later, I saw a picture of Nick Drake. And Nick Drake is walking his dog, and I love dogs. But he happened to be walking his dog past the exact flat that I was living in when I was losing my mind. And the synchronicity of the universe is a source of wonderment. This is a very special track for me.
I never felt magic crazy as this. I never saw moons, knew the meaning of the sea.
I never held the motion in the palm of my hand. I felt sweet breezes in the top of a tree, but now you're here. Brighten my northern sky.
That was Nick Drake and Northern Sky. So, Sue Perkins, your partner is the documentary maker and TV presenter Anna Richardson, and you've been together about 3 years. You've said she's good at allowing me to have fun. So when you are not working, how do you enjoy your free time?
We just play. There's a lot of stress involved in life, and she's just been extremely good at puncturing that side of me that wants to analyse and that wants to fret. And giving permission to the toddler, in the same way that Mel does. We love just being in nature. I'm happiest when I'm in a wood or a forest, and I can just sit for hours and look at bluebells or wonder if I should eat that mushroom without any degree of knowledge about which mushrooms are poisonous or not. And, you know, we love animals, and it's a lovely thing, really. We don't talk about work. My job is my job, and God, I love it. But I really do leave it at the front door, because the commissioning structure of the BBC or ITV holds no interest for me, and office politics. It's a real privilege to do what I do. But then I can leave it behind and go, right, what's for dinner?
Can I ask you about the dog thing?
Yes.
Because those of us who've got the dog thing in our life feel very strongly about it. And I see photographs of you sometimes with your dog, and it seems to be, this will sound weird to some people, but it seems to be a big thing in your life.
Huge thing in my life. I never had pets because, well, this sums up my parents perfectly. My mum just thought that they would bring me out in hives. So the catastrophising parent thought, you know, I'd get, if I had a cat, would get immediately get toxoplasmosis. And so when I got a dog, I couldn't believe how joyous it was. My dogs helped me through the darkest time. And when my dog died, a bit of me died. But, you know, there's another dog in my life now, and just sort of big, silly, coquettish rescue mutt. It's just brilliant. To give an animal a second chance to rehome a dog is a great thing.
There's been a great deal of speculation about what you will do next, given that you are not going to grace us with your presence on Bake Off. What are you going to do next professionally?
As ever, I don't really know. I finished recording this big trip to India, which was very, very challenging. And I went very shortly after Dad died to the Himalayas. And that was a place of total isolation. And it really, really properly messed me up. There's no airs and graces. It's all on camera. Altitude sickness and throwing up and crying and really feeling at one with nature and being profoundly kind of overawed by it all. Next, some more travel. And I'm very hopeful that Mel and I will do some prattling about, but I couldn't tell you exactly what yet. It's all to play for, it's all right, it's all okay.
Prattling about BBC One primetime, I'm imagining.
Possibly primetime prattling. Already it sounds like some of the reviews coming
That's
in.
That's the title right
yeah,
there.
Yeah, primetime prattling.
Now, I get the impression that food has played a big part in your life, not just the cakes, but all the stuff we were hearing about. If you were to imagine a desert island dish, what would be the thing that would be your sort of final meal? What has been the most sublime?
Before I head off?
Yes.
Oh, that's difficult. I've been lucky to eat in so many brilliant places and to try the most extraordinary, rarefied cuisine. But I would really have to be true to my heart and go for just something that reminded me of home. I would go for one of my mum's soups. It's a really good, hearty lentil soup.
Oh.
I'd go for a roast chicken dinner, but I'd have Yorkshire puddings because, come on, it doesn't have to just be for beef. And I'd end with a trifle. Who wouldn't want to go out in a blaze of trifle?
Oh, I'm coming to your house. Yeah. Tell me about your final piece of music then. What are we going to hear?
This last piece, I love Philip Glass. I think Philip Glass is just the gateway to so many interesting different types of music. But I'm picking him because of a very particular evening in Edinburgh. And Anne and I just got together, and it was a difficult time. And I thought, I think she likes Philip Glass, and Philip Glass is playing. And it was just one of those moments where everything comes together. And we sat down, and we were in the circle of the King's Theatre, and Philip Glass came out, and he played what I now know is Anna's favourite piece of music, and one of my favourites too. And without having to even look at each other, we were holding hands, and we just cried our eyes out. And at that moment, that piece of music was being played just for us. And in all the horror of sometimes what it's like to be alive, isn't it just wonderful?
was Philip Glass playing the opening from Glassworks. Sue Perkins, it's time for me to give you the books. I give everybody the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare, and they get to take a third book. What's yours going to be?
How to Clone a Dog.
So I'm going to ask you what your luxury is, and what is it related to that?
Yes.
What is it?
Some of my dog's hair. My deceased dog's hair.
You might need a whole laboratory, and I'm not giving you that as well.
No,
so
I will find a way.
All right.
Love always finds a way, Kirsty.
I admire your
optimism.
So
my luxury item would be a little bit of hair from my naughty ex-beagle Pickle.
Okay.
And the book would be How to Clone Your Dog.
All right. Both of those things you must have then. Finally, which...
Victory!
did you think they wouldn't get through?
I was really worried.
No,
really, because
fine.
There isn't a book called How to Clone Your Dog.
But well, there might be. In an act of blind faith,
yes.
I'm going to imagine that somebody somewhere is at least writing that book as we speak. Which track of the eight would you save?
I would save Moments of Pleasure by Kate Bush, because she's the artist that has followed me through my entire life. And in listening to that track, I'd be able to think of all that she represents and all the ways that she's been my mate, despite the fact I don't know her. I'd just like to thank her, and so I'd like to take her with me.
It's yours. Sue Perkins, thank you very much for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you so much.
You've been listening to a download from the BBC. You'll find more information on the Radio 4 website, bbc.co.uk/radio4.
This is the BBC.